हेलो नमस्कार एंड आदाब टू ऑल माय फ्रेंड्स फ्रॉम योर फ्रेंड एस्ट्रोलॉजर एंड गाइड इरफान वंस मोर विथ यू फ्रॉम योर वेरी ओन चैनल एस्ट्रो एश्योरेंस. व्हेन वी मेक आवर गोल्स एंड व्हेन वी ओरिएंट आवरसेल्व्स टू सर्टेन रिजल्ट्स इन लाइफ वी ट्राई एंड लुक एट दोज एरियाज व्हिच फॉर अस फ्रॉम अ एनवायरमेंट पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू सीम्स टू बी द एरिया व्हिच कैन बी मोर रिवॉर्डिंग फॉर अस एंड दिस इज द एरिया वेयर वी कैन बी मोर सक्सेसफुल एज वेल. Sometimes we take decisions based on what our strengths are in general life, where we think that I'm good in engineering or I'm good in the arts and I'm good in say social sciences. So based on that we also choose what our goals should be, where the goals can manifest themselves better, where we can get higher probability of success, and then we try and traverse that path. We get educational qualifications on that, and then we try to put in an effort to get success in those areas. And sometimes we also look at how the astrological placements support those goals and whether we have a higher chance of success in those areas based on what the astrological placements are telling us. However, we know that one of the most critical aspects of success in life is also based on how strong the ascendant is and how strong the ascendant lord is. Shlokas after shlokas have told us whether it is the Brihat Parashara Hora Shastra or the Fal Deepika or the Jataka Tattva, whatever you look at it, that if the ascendant and the ascendant lord both are strongly afflicted, then the chance of higher success in life, higher prosperity in life, higher abundance in life, higher happiness in life is all reduced substantially. And in fact, we may attract more challenges, more problems, more upheavals when both the ascendant is strongly afflicted as well as the ascendant lord or the Lagna lord is strongly afflicted. Then the question arises, and a very important one is that how strong is our ascendant supporting the goals that we have in life? Have we aligned our goals to what the strengths the ascendant is providing, what the ascendant lord is bringing to the table by virtue of giving a higher chance of success in a certain area? And if we don't look at this, then we will be shooting in the dark and the struggle will be on and on, and many times such success comes to us more by default rather than design. If you truly want to design your way to success, it is important that you look at the overall combinations of different planetary energies in the horoscope, and one of the critical aspects or the contribution to that success is also the strength of the ascendant and the strength and placement of the ascendant lord or the Lagna lord. So firstly, what is the ascendant? The ascendant is the sign which is rising in the eastern horizon at the time of our birth, and that becomes the ascendant for us, and that is what is the approach to our life that we have based on what the ascendant stands for. So if the ascendant is Leo, leadership, putting our best foot forward and leading by example, being somebody who is ready to take on responsibilities, leading with self-respect, leading with pride, wanting authority, all these are the manifestation of the Leo sign, for example, if you are in the Leo ascendant. And similarly, all the ascendants bring a certain quality to the native, a certain approach to life, a certain approach to different areas of life, to challenges of life, and also to goals of the life. Now, if the ascendant is strong, then it helps us to strongly manifest the different characteristics of the ascendant and use it to our advantage. However, if the ascendant is weak, then obviously the strengths of the ascendant are definitely not supporting our goals, and hence it is important to align our goals to what strength the ascendant is bringing. So the ascendant is the rising sign in the eastern horizon at the time of our birth. However, one of the areas that aspects or it affects the strength of the ascendant is the degrees of the ascendant. Say for example, if the ascendant is just about rising at say 1 or 2 degrees, then if you make a strong chart versus house versus sign, so if the house is 0 to 30 degrees, for example, and the ascendant is at 0 and some degrees at the start, which means the ascendant has not completely come within the house, but it is at the start, at the starting phase of entering into that house, if you take the house to be 0 to 30 degrees. So then if the ascendant is at 1 or 2 degrees, which means the last sign has not completely gone off, has not completely gone over the horizon to allow the new sign to rise, and so the major part of the last sign is still occupying the first house. So the first house is still occupied by the last sign, which is just going off, and the rising sign is slowly entering, which means the last sign will have, or the last sign energies will have a major, major influence on the Lagna or on the first house results. Now Parashara says that when, even if you have a few degrees of a certain sign in the Lagna, then you take the entire Lagna as that. Now we have also introduced the Bhav Chalit and so forth, but I will talk about Bhav Chalit in some other video. But then you take the entire sign as that one house, even if it is, it's at 1 degrees or 2 degrees, or it's at 28 or 29 degrees, which is almost, it is descending into over the horizon, for example. So it is important for us to understand at what degrees the ascendant is. And so if the ascendant has to be truly very, very strong, then the ascendant between 10 to 20 degrees is the most strong ascendant, because it is more or less occupying the mid portion of the first house of the Lagna. Then the ascendant will manifest its energies, its characteristics, its strength very strongly to the native. But if it's at 1 or 2 degrees at the start, for example, it is 1 or 2 degrees of Aries, then you will know that major part of the house, the first house, the Lagna, is still occupied by the last sign, which is Pisces. However, if it's at the fag end, say at 27, 28 degrees, so major portion of the sign has already gone over the horizon. 1 or 2 degrees are only left at the time of the birth of the native. And the sign which is coming next, if it is 27, 28 degrees Aries at the time of somebody's birth on the eastern horizon, then it means that the last 2-3 degrees are occupying the ascendant, the rest 27 to 28 degrees are being occupied by the next sign, which is Taurus. So the Taurus sign will have a major impact on the Lagna, on the first house, rather than that of the Aries sign. So however, because we look at the entire house as the sign which is rising at the time of one's birth, and so you take the first house as Aries. However, don't forget that the, if it's at 1 or 2 degrees, then Pisces sign still has a huge impact on the Lagna. And if it's at 27 to 28 degrees, then Taurus sign, the emerging sign, will have a large impact on the characteristics of the Lagna. And it will be influencing it, will also be influencing the native, will also be influencing the strength by virtue of the sign's manifestation to the individual. So that has to be kept in mind when you're analyzing the strength of the ascendant. And keep in mind that when, if you are at 1 or 2 degrees of Aries ascendant, then because the major part of the ascendant of the first house is still being occupied by Pisces sign, which is though retreating, which means that a lot of Pisces energies will be controlling the ascendant. That means that if you are being more creative, more imaginative in how you approach life, how you approach goal, then it is better that being too headstrong, which the Aries brings in. So Pisces energy is more imaginative, more creative, more fluid, more changeable. So it's a strength that the Pisces sign brings in by virtue of those energies. So even if you're born in the Aries ascendant, but if you are at 1 or 2 degrees, that means that you need to try and be more creative in your dissemination, try be more imaginative, and try and be more changeable and ready to be very flexible. And also think out of the box, think beyond the boundaries of what you think are the hardwired walls, and be more ready to go and push the boundaries of your goals. And then you will find that you will get more success, because the strong Pisces energies are now favoring you. On the other hand, if it's at 27 to 28 degrees of Aries, then that means only 1 or 2 degrees of the Lagna or the first house are being occupied by Aries. The last 2 degrees of Aries, the rest of it is being occupied by almost 27 to 20 degrees of Taurus. Then you need to bring in or use the Taurus energies more related to what goals you have, and that will give you more success. So being more materialistic, being more hardwired towards your goals, being more bullish. So Taurus energy is more bull energy, so being more strongly attached to the goals, not letting your mind to waver, and not being too flexible in your goals is the way of the Taurus, the way of the bull. So keep that in mind. So what ascendant you are in terms of degrees is very important, because the sign also contributes to the manifestation and the strength of the ascendant. But if it's between say 5, 6, 7 degrees to 22, 23, 24 degrees also, still then the particular sign will occupy major strengths, and only small influence of the other signs, the previous sign or the next sign, is there. So if it's between 7 or 8 degrees of Aries to almost 22, 23 degrees of Aries, still Aries sign will occupy the major part of the first house and will be influencing the characteristics, and the strengths will manifest stronger to the individual. So keep this in mind as part of the strength of the ascendant. Second thing is also, what are the malefics or benefits aligned to the ascendant by virtue of either being placed in them or aspecting it. So if there are more benefits placed in the ascendant, then obviously they are adding strength to the results of the ascendant. And so if your goals are aligned to the nature of the ascendant, the various vocations that the ascendant brings, the strengths that the ascendant brings, then you will get obviously more success in that. However, your ascendant is very strong at say 15 to 16 degrees, but there are more malefics either placed in the ascendant or aspecting the ascendant, then they are taking away a lot of positive energy from the ascendant and adding upheavals, adding challenges, adding issues there. Which means then you need to be wary of what challenges can come in, what issues can come in, and to take a backseat when the dasha of a malefic is on, or a transit of the same malefic over itself is on in the natal chart. So you need to be more wary and make your moves when the ascendant dasha is on, or a benefic dasha is on. Especially if the benefic is getting attached to the ascendant, either by being the lord of the ascendant, or aspecting the ascendant, or being placed in the ascendant, or involved in a yoga with the ascendant. For example, if Jupiter is in the lagna and moon is in the 10th house, then they are kendra to each other, so it's a strong gajakesari yoga. So if the dasha of even moon is on, but Jupiter will also be activated, because the dasha is that of moon, which is involved in a gajakesari yoga with Jupiter. So keep that in mind and make your moves accordingly, then you also get more results, or better results then. And lie low, or keep the ship steadfast, don't rock the boat too much, and try and focus on stability during the dasha of malefics if they are passing over the ascendant, and if you are align the goals to your ascendant, because the ascendant is very, very strong. So being more tactical, being more clever, being more calculated in when to push results, when not to, when to do things, when not to, is important. When the ascendant is very strong, but one or two malefics gets attached to it, either by being placed in it or expecting it. So those upheavals will come from time to time, but yet you can get very, very good results, because it is good to use the strengths of the ascendant, because they are important from overall results of the life and overall results of the ascendant lord. So keep this in mind, if the ascendant has any attached benefits by virtue of being placed, benefits placed in the ascendant or aspecting it, or some yogas being involved including the ascendant or the ascendant lord, then the ascendant is very strong, and don't lose those energies. Use every inch of energy that the ascendant is giving to you and manifest it. The other hand is the ascendant lord. If the ascendant lord is also placed in a strong sign, and in the sign of a friend, or its own sign, especially its Mool Trikon sign, or even in its exaltation sign, then it's a very, very strong placement. Generally, all the seven planets will have the exaltation sign, which is not their ascendant, except Mercury. Mercury is the only planet which, if placed in its Mool Trikon sign, which is this Virgo sign, which is also its exaltation sign, can be the Lagna. The rest of the six planets cannot have the same ascendant, as well as the exaltation sign being the same. So the ascendant will be a different sign and the exaltation sign will be different. So if the ascendant lord is exalted, then you should be able to align both the energies strongly and see which houses they are ruling. So for a Sagittarius ascendant native, Jupiter rules the Lagna, and the 8th house is where Jupiter gets exalted for a Sagittarius ascendant native, especially because Sagittarius is also its Mool Trikona sign. So then look at how you can bring together the 8th house energies along with the Lagna energies based on Jupiter's strength in the 8th house, because Cancer is the sign of exaltation. So if it's at close to its exaltation degree or moving away from its exaltation degree, keep that in mind and use both the strengths of the 8th house and the Lagna to manifest results accordingly. So this can be a very, very strong placement for people in finance, in economics, in the government, in also in wealth management, in taxation audits, even insurance. Very, very strong placement if Jupiter is the Lagna lord for Sagittarius ascendant natives and then it's in the exaltation sign in the 8th house. So very, very good research. A professor who's indulging in research and manifesting results is also seen. However, we know only one planetary placement will not give you results. So how the overall energies combine and give you or promise you results should be seen. The other thing is the Lagna lord in some yogas? So one is, we saw that if the ascendant has is involved in a yoga is one, or the Lagna lord itself is involved in the yoga also, then use the energies of the yoga also to see how it is relating to your goals. So for example, if you are having the Taurus ascendant, Saturn becomes a very strong yoga karaka planet because it is ruling now both the 9th and 10th houses. And if the Lagna lord is also placed in the 10th house, for example, in Aquarius, then it's a very, very strong placement also, because here Taurus is also ruling the Venus, which rules Taurus, is also ruling the 6th house of service. So this can also be an excellent placement for success in accounts, in finance, in wealth management, and also related to services which are related to Venus, which are hospitality and salons and resorts. Luxury oriented services can also be seen, and if Saturn is also very well placed, then it can give you very good success. So now if Venus is placed in Aquarius but is also involved in a strong yoga, then it's a very, very strong placement also of good success related to the energies of Venus. So then align your goals or your career goals or your life goals to how the ascendant is, how strong it is, and how strong is the ascendant lord. If for some reason you find that the ascendant is also very weak and the ascendant lord is also very weak, then try and see which are the strongest planets in the horoscope and use those energies and look at how those energies are helping you, which direction they are pointing towards, which vocations or what career they are pointing you towards, and then move in that direction. Second, also try and inculcate habits or attitude of that ascendant rather than continue to showcase the ascendant, which is a weak one. So if the ascendant is strong in terms of degrees but weak in terms of negative placements in it, and Lagna lord also being combusted or debilitated, then you need to be careful of whether you want to continue to showcase the same behavior. So you can continue to showcase the same behavior in terms of principles and values and approach to life. However, showcase that behavior which your career is manifesting by taking on the energies of that ascendant. So if you have a Leo Lagna but your 12th house is very, very strong, then while you can continue to be principled and carry your values in terms of self-respect, in terms of leadership, because you have a Leo Lagna, but if Leo is very weak, Sun is very weak, but the 12th house is very powerful because the 12th house has one or two benefits in it, Moon itself is placed very, very strong, then you carry the 12th house energies or sign energies. The sign is Cancer, so try to be more nurturing, try to be more supportive, try to come across and help people more, be more empathetic, lend an empathetic ear to people. You will find that you will get more success when you combine the energy of the ascendant and the strongest signs in the horoscope. So here the combinations are important. I have said this many times. It's a combination which brings you results and not one placement alone. So use these energies together to manifest the results and align that goal in that direction, rather than look at only ascendant or ascendant lord or only the strongest sign in the, or strongest house and strongest planet in the horoscope, which may not be the ascendant or the ascendant lord. The other is to use the energies which a debilitated Lagna lord is bringing to you. So if the Lagna lord is debilitated, then use the opposing or opposite energies of that Lagna lord to try and get more success. For example, if Mercury is debilitated, then Mercury loses all its analytical ability, its practical ability, and captures or gathers the opposing energy, which is more creative, which is more imaginative. So if we know that Mercury gets debilitated in Pisces, which is the 12th house, and Pisces also represents imagination, it also represents creative. So which means if Mercury is debilitated, then your creative strengths are enhanced. And lot of people who have got very high literary success in fictional writing have also had a weak Mercury, even combusted or even a debilitated Mercury. So the opposing energy of the Lagna Lord will manifest itself strongly. So if your Lagna Lord is debilitated, use the opposing or opposite energies of the Lagna Lord and use that energies along with what other sign is very, very strong, which other house is very strong, which other planets are very strong, and combine those creativity of say a debilitated Mercury and the strength of Sun if it is very strong, or the strength of Jupiter if that is very, very strong, or the strength of Saturn which is very, very strong, and combine the energies and then try and find a goal and a career related to the combination of results, keeping in mind which house they represent, and you will find that you will get more success in that direction. The other is that in today's times, we have a multitude of options or career options related to any sign and related to any planet. It is not like 300, 400 years back where the options were very, very limited in terms of what career you could do, what profession you could follow, what vocation you could do. So there are multitude of areas today. So even if your ascendant is weak, if your ascendant lord is very weak, then because you if you are combining the energy of the ascendant along with the strongest planet, then there are various ways in which you can manifest it. So if you deep dive and find where the energy lies, which house it is, and you will also get some sign, some signal. So in the process of growing up, if you see that regularly you get success in some area, you're getting success in sports, you're getting success in writing, you're getting success in mathematics, you're getting success in science, then that is a sign that those areas are strong for you, those planets also strong for you. Then sit down and take notice, is there any career which could be related to these strengths, and are there strong placements that you can get continued success in that direction rather than only temporary success. Sometimes a strong dasha can give you limited success for 10 to 15 years during even your growing areas, and later on you may take the same ball and run forward and you may not get that success. So for example, being very good at sports in your young days because your Mars dasha is on and Mars is strong, but later on you try to get more success continuing that as a sports person, but you may not get that success. So be very, very careful of what dashas are coming in the period of between your 20 to 21 years and between your 40 years. Those dashas become most critical because that is a takeoff time for you. So if you during that time spend more energies on the vocation or career or action related to a planet which is very, very weak, then the dasha of that planet is on. Some strength of course the planet will acquire, but not much. And so at the end of the entire dasha, say Venus 20 years, Venus is weak, but you're following something in the direction of Venus, and the 20 years will give ups and downs and upheavals. You may still get good success, but you may not enjoy great success, and even the good success will come to you after a lot of struggle. So keep in mind which planets are strongest and which is the dasha which is coming those during the crucial years. If the dasha of a very weak planet is coming during those crucial years, then use the opposing energy of the planet and try and see if you can enhance the strength or use the strength of something else which is sharing energies with that planet. So Venus is getting connected in some way through conjunction or aspects or yogas with any other planet which is strong, then during Venus's dasha, using those energies and having a career or vocation or business in that direction will give you greater success. So always try and align your life goals with the ascendant's goal, ascendant strength along with the ascendant lords, and complement it with the strength of the other strongest planets in the horoscope, other strongest houses in the horoscope, and then use the combined strength for success rather than trying to run with only one. If you run with only one and if you have put all your eggs in one basket and that basket is weak, all your eggs may crash and you may break them. So learn how to look at overall energies, how they are relating to ascendant, how they are relating to if not the ascendant, to the ascendant Lord, some signals, some conjunctions, some planetary strengths will always be there. You just need to look in carefully, just as I gave the example of Leo ascendant and moon being strong, and using those energies, complementing energies, put together your career goals, put together your life goals, and then use these energies and be consistent in that area, in that manifestation, and persevere so that you get a higher crack at success. So friends, look into your own horoscopes and understand what your ascendant is, how strong your ascendant is. Is it between the strong degrees, or is it weaker, or is it combusted? Is it at the fag end of the ascendant's degrees, or at start of the ascendant degrees? Then use either of the other signs, energies, strength, where the ascendant Lord is placed, what yogas it is. If it's still not having so much energy, then see what other houses and planets it is combining or complementing energies with, and use those energies to get higher success. So friends, like this video, share this video and subscribe to my channel. And if you're looking for a personal consultation from me, please reach out to me at the links given below. Until some other time with some other video, this is your friend, astrologer and guide Irfan, signing off. Ciao.